Hi everyone, my name is Tong Lei. I'm one of the faculty in pediatric dentistry here at University of California, San Francisco. As a part of PD-109, I will present this lecture. The title is Care Risk Assessment and Disease Prevention. So care risk assessment, disease prevention is such an important topic. The thing is that this can be done by any non-dental provider. It could be done by nurses, could be done by pediatricians. It's so important because dental diseases is like infectious disease where we have to assess risk. So once you identify the risk category, whether low, medium, or high, then we can provide specific intervention to the parents and the child. Okay. So the objective of this lecture is to inspire the medical and the dental personnel to evaluate the oral health status in infant and young children, be able to assess caries risk and individualize the intervention and appropriate recall, meaning that certain individual with low risk, perhaps you don't have to see them once every 6 months, but maybe once every 12 months, even 18 months for that matter. And those that are at high risk or extremely high risk, you can bring them back probably 3 to 4 months instead of 6 months. Okay, and demonstrate the key elements to address how to do the need to knee exam. Also promote the use of fluorides and dental sealants as a way to prevent caries formation. Understand and promote the use of early intervention techniques and try to engage the parents into the motivational interview. Try to establish more set of goals that are achievable. And finally, try to promote healthy daily family behavior for the optimal oral health and reset a young child on the lifetime path of good oral hygiene and oral health. So you too, I mean everybody here, healthcare provider, the PCP, the primary care provider, dental or medical, who can see young children and learn how to do care risk assessment. And again, it's such an important concept because we can tailor specific treatment and recommendation for the young child early on in life. So what is early childhood caries? I mean, early childhood caries is any tooth decay. I mean, even incipient caries, the earliest cavity formation, okay, including previous experience extractions, previous experience of dental fillings, in primary dentition. So, this is some example of early childhood carry. They have very distinctive pattern of tooth decay. It usually begins on the upper primary teeth, and then slowly they're progressing toward the other teeth as they erupted, particularly on the posterior molar on the upper and then on the lower. Now, once in a while, we do see caries on the lower anterior teeth. That is extremely severe case. Usually caries don't occur lower anterior. The rationale, the reason being, the tongue have a very natural cleansing. And when the child speak, eat, and talk, they cleanse the lingual side and therefore remove the black binding. However, now and then we do see caries pattern on the lower anterior incisor. Once that happens, this child has a very high severe risk, meaning that I bet you there are great chance that caries will develop also on the posterior molars in most cases, in a severe dental caries pattern even. Now, early childhood caries in California. California is known to be the high-tech state, the affluent state in the United States. However, our children fall well below the national and oral health, okay? About one-third of preschoolers and almost 70% of children ranging from grade kindergarten to third grade have experienced tooth decay. And this data extracted from 2006 California Smile Survey. Treatment of early childhood caries. Interestingly, I mean, it seems like it doesn't matter what dentist perform in dental office, if without a good oral hygiene at home, all this dental decay will come back. So you can see the statistic indicated that 40 to 50% of children treated with severe early childhood carry will have a new decay within half a year to a year. So Why? Because all the poor oral hygiene, all the lack of bacteria, still there. I mean, we haven't actually removed the etiology. We primarily come in and excavate it carelessly in order to decay and do the filling. But the real etiology, the real cause of dental caries, still there. So all the plaque would continue to come back. Interestingly, if we go to do a prophy, right, the prophy would clean remove the plaque, but would pull all hygiene, all that plaque material, will repopulate the teeth surface in about two days. I mean, if we do culture to compare before the prophy and 2 or 3 days after the prophy, the count probably similar. So that tells you how important it is to be into establish a good oral hygiene at home. So it's clearly that the dental restoration or dental fillings alone do not solve the problems. Therefore, we must think about to treat the infection, meaning that we have to start up with education to the parents, okay, teach the parents how to help a young child, because as a child, they don't have the manual dexterity to clean teeth until 6 years old. But at the same time, we want them to practice how to clean teeth and brushings early. But at the end of the day, parents have to jump in and rebrush so they can properly mechanically deprive the plaque that sticks onto the tooth surface. And also, we have to think about recommendations of low carigenic diets, as well as other prevention mechanisms, such as use of fluoridated toothpaste, fluoridated water drinking water. And if we see a child have caries with high risk, perhaps we have to prescribe some of the fluoride supplement, for example. Okay. So, I mean, we have to take everything into consideration to prevent caries formation from happening again. So, a lot of time parents would ask, on their baby teeth, right? They're going to fall off anyway, so who cares? Well, the fact of the matter is, primary teeth are quite important. Why? They're important for eating, for nutrition, holding in space, talking, and smiling. So teeth are important for mastication, swallowing, for proper nutrients and bodily development. It also holds space. The reason being, if a child has premature loss of primary teeth, the adjacent teeth will move and the space is closed. So then the premolar, the permanent teeth, will erupt eventually and there will be no adequate space to accommodate the dimension, the size of permanent teeth. The teeth become crowded, so they erupt either buccal or lingually, and therefore they need orthodontic treatment, which can be very expensive and very costly. Second, if the tooth is infected, infections is acidic environment, it causes bone destructions and potentially damage the permanent developing tooth bud in bone. Okay? And in some severe cases, the child develops swelling, facial cellulitis, fever can be involved. And in some severe cases, it's potentially obstruct airway, okay, or is spread into the brain, could be a life-threatening situation. It is extremely rare, however, but if you search Google, there are reported rare, okay, but there are reported documented cases of child die because of dental infection. And it's important for talking and smiling for aesthetic concern. I mean, so clearly this is critical and so important that we have to care for primary teeth until the adult teeth come in and replace them. The two primary functions for primary teeth are there to function and there to act as a spay retainer for future permanent teeth. Those are the two main things, function and retainer. White spot lesion. So the first visible sign of tooth decay is decalcification. As you may notice that the chalky, white chalky appearance on the upper primary incisor along the gingiva. This is early incipient caries, meaning that they can be reversible process. We can keep the teeth clean with improved oral hygiene, brush with fluoridated toothpaste. The use of fluoride can remin the incipient caries by reuptake calcium and phosphate ion in saliva and create a hard layer so that the caries will be arrested. So if not being treated, they get worse and become cavitated, then the child would need to do a filling. If detect late, it could get into the pulp and cause infections and a whole host of other problems that I mentioned in the previous slide. No one orders. Early childhood caries, dental caries, completely can be prevented. This is disease of habit, okay, primary poor oral hygiene, not brushing teeth. But if a child, parents can help to establish a good oral hygiene at home by brushing teeth in the morning, at night, reduce the frequency and durations of sugary challenge, and reduce the exposure to fermentable carbohydrate that can break down to glucose and the carogenic bacteria such as Streptomycin and Lactobacilli. These are bacteria that are going to consume glucose and they divide and then they form a thick, heavy plaque. It's a good lactic acid, drop the pH, and the pH, low lactic acid pH, would known to cause demineralization. Okay, that is the primary mechanism of caries formation. So the way we prevent it, we introduce fluoride, and the fluoride promote remineralization, okay, and reduce demineralization, and also fluoride known to kill the bacteria, okay, in the process. So, but for a young child, it's also very important to do intervention, okay, with the pregnant women and the mothers of an infant. Why? The reason being that the bacteria can be transmitted. It's a vertical transmission from mom to the child, right? To sharing food, utensil, to kissing, etc. So if a mom no dental caries experience, then most likely they have low count bacteria and less chance for transmission. And the reverse is true when a parent, dad or mom, or even primary care provider, primary caretaker of a child have active caries, active disease, high bacterial count. Those bacteria can potentially transmit it onto a young child and cause high risk for decay development. Okay, and the interventions should take place among babies and young children. In fact, the American Academy of Pediatric Dentistry recommend that the first visit to the dentist should be within the first years of age. During this time, primary teeth begin to develop, particularly lower two central incisors. They come in around 6-7 months or so, and followed by the upper incisor, then the lower lateral, upper lateral, and first primary molar. Okay, that's within the first year of life. And then during the second years of life, you will see canine will erupt, and then eventually second primary molar. By 2-2.5 years old, a child should have a full primary dentition, 10 baby teeth on top, 10 baby teeth on the bottom, then all the way until 6-6.5 years old, then lower two central incisors will exfoliate, then permanent teeth begin to erupt at 6 or 7 years old, and they last until 12 years old, when the second premolar followed by the second permanent molars, and that would almost complete the permanent dentition until 18, 21 years old. By then, the wisdom teeth will erupt, okay? Okay, so ways to prevent early childhood caries. We use water fluoridation, so we introduce fluoride ions in water. In the old day, the supplement is about 1 part per million of fluoride, but now we reduce down to 0.7 part per million. The reason, because when a child drinking water, this fluoride ion in water would have direct contact on tooth surfaces and therefore promote remineralization and prevent demineralization, okay, before the water can be swallowed. The plaintiff research now indicated that the beneficial effect of fluoride for caries prevention, actually a topical action, not a systematic action. So really the child didn't have to swallow that fluoride amount in order to get the beneficial effect of caries prevention. It's all about topical interaction onto the tooth surface. So the idea is that fluoride, which is minusly charged ion, interact with positively charged ions of hydroxyapatite and promote to enhance the harder outer surface of the fluoridated carbonate hydroxyapatite, okay? Second, we can use fluoride varnish. This is professional applications. then try the baby teeth, and then apply the fluoride varnish, okay? It's important to try teeth first before you apply. The reason, because varnish will set when it contacts saliva. So you try the teeth first, you apply the varnish, and then it contacts saliva, the resin will set, and they stick better and to sustain a slow release of fluoride ions over a long period of time. We also use sealants, okay? Sealants is a resin material which can be applied onto the pit and groove and fissure of the teeth. I mean, evolution created that. The tooth anatomy held the pit and fissure, but a lot of time bacteria and food get in there and it's difficult to remove. And so caries prone to develop. Those are very susceptible, high risk surfaces for caries development. So by placing sealant, it could be resin based, could be glass or enamel based, it will seal the surface and therefore prevent caries from forming. Daily toothbrush with fluoride toothpaste is also important. Regular toothpaste contains fluoride, so about 1,100 or so parts per million of fluoride. It doesn't matter whether toothpaste is a sodium fluoride at 0.24%. Okay, you convert to parts per million, that's roughly about 1,100. Okay, parts per million. If you use standard fluoride at 0.4%, there seems to be higher percentage. But if once an individual calculate the parts per million, it should be the same, 1,100 parts per million of fluoride ion. So there's not a whole lot of difference between adult toothpaste and children toothpaste. Also, same concentration of fluoride ions. That is the active ingredient, okay? The only difference is taste. Adult perhaps have mint in there. Kids do not tolerate mint too well. The reason, because it's spicy and they're gonna cry. Children toothpaste bland, tastes really bland. And also they put a little sparkling, make it fun, okay? But in reality, they're identical. I mean, sometimes in adult toothpaste, the Sensodyne, it varies a little bit by putting potassium nitrate, some Colgate. They're going to introduce some triclosan for anti-gingivitis, potassium nitrate and Sensodyne for sensitivity teeth, you know, so a little variation, not too much, but the active ingredient, fluoride, ion concentration are identical, okay? Whether it is standard fluoride or sodium fluoride. So when you use toothpaste, we need to apply just a tiny amount, like a pea size or smear layer. We do not need to apply the whole blob, okay? That's just too much. And a young child tends to swallow, okay? If you apply a little bit, a smear layer, the tip of the toothbrush, that's plenty. If a child swallow, no problem, okay? If you apply a whole blob, it could be a problem if they keep swallowing. It can taste good. If they keep swallowing chronically over time, which may result in a chalky appearance of teeth, they call fluorosis, okay? And the mechanism of fluorosis is very, some is known, being that the fluoride, when they enter into circulation, is a systematic effect that will interfere with cellular function, protein secretion, enzyme activities, and it would compromise the enamel matrix formation, give rise to undercalcify or hypocalcify appearance of the enamel and chalky appearance. So, and depend on severity of the concentration of just the fluoride. Therefore, the severity of fluorosis as well, okay? Also very important, the dietary changing. I mean, the idea is we don't want a child who suck on a bottle with milk and walk around the house all day long or when they sleep with the bottle. Bottle milk contain a lot of sugar in it, and so constant exposure, frequency and duration is a very important concept. We have to reduce that frequency and duration because the constant exposure of sugar onto the teeth surface would promote bacterial growth and therefore lactic acid drop the pH and caries tend to develop. Not only milk, but any fermentable carbohydrate sources, I mean, food that's sticky could be detrimental to teeth. Banana sounds to be a healthy fruit, but actually contain a lot of sugar as well. So be careful. You want to feed the child, feed them, okay? Then stop it. Make sure you brush it in the morning and at night. And if at night they want a bottle or something, they cry, give bottled water, okay? Absolutely no. No bottle of milk at night because that's going to give rise to rampant dental caries. And treatment could be very difficult because a young child, particularly under 3 years old, they're not yet able to cooperate. They're in the pre-cooperative stage of development, and If they have dental caries, you can't sedate them because they're so small, under 30 pounds perhaps, and it could be dangerous to sedate in any dental office, which is completely contraindicated. Therefore, the only option left to do it is either have to go to general anesthesia to fix it, or nowadays we use quite a bit of SDF, which is sulfadiamine fluoride, to control or arrest the decay quite effectively. And sometimes we even, if possible, we do SMART, which means that SMART is a procedure that we apply SDF and then follow with future triage, which is class of anima restoration. And that can arrest the active disease quite well. All right, fluoride varnish. All right. Fluoride varnish is very easy to apply topically. It is very safe for babies and young children. And the way we apply, we dry the teeth, we applied it, and then we ask the child to spit out all the excess or suction out all the excess. I mean, no eating or drinking for perhaps an hour. One does not have to brush teeth that night. Okay, and the resin from the fluoride varnish will retain onto the tooth surface and slow release of fluoride ions over several days. Okay, this is an example of dental sealant. I mean, dental sealant, they come in many flavors, but mainly they break down into resin base, right? Or glass ionomer base, or resin modified glass ionomer. If it is a resin base, then the teeth have to completely isolate it, etch, bone dry it before it's being applied like here. Whereas if it's glass ionomer base, it's less moisture sensitive. So depending on the scenario and you decide to choose what material you should apply. The idea is this material is gonna flow into a deep groove, pit and fissure, and seal it so they prevent the impaction of food and bacteria and prevent caries forming. Okay, dietary counseling. These are some example of soda where they contain high concentration of sugar as well as carbonic acid, low and acidic. I mean, orange juice is also another one too. I mean, it's loaded with sugar in it, and it contains citric acid, which is acidic, okay? Try to limit the amount of sugary food and drinks. Limit the simple carbohydrates, like white crackers, okay? Try to limit both frequency and duration and the total sugar intake. Encourage drinking water. It's free, it's cheap, and it's a healthy drink, okay? Eat fresh fruits, vegetable snack, etc., and try to avoid sticky candy, because when a child eats sticky candy, they're gonna get stuck onto the tooth surface for over a long period of time. Now, we all know that sugar is not a good thing to eat. The reason because they give chronic inflammation to the body, and you rise to diabetes type 2 or obesity among children at alarming rate. So we try to reduce that amount. So that's why dentistry does not practice in vacuum, but we have to work with other systematic disease prevention, just as medical doctors. So together we can educate the parents and children on how to limit the amount and the frequency of sugar intake. It's vegetable. Look at all the kids. Okay, weaning. The recommendation is to using the cup at 6 months of age, but consider weaning after a year or to a year and a half, so that the child will not have to depend too much on the bottle. Also, try to get rid of pacifier and the oral habit by then as well, because prolonged pacifier use and thumb development to thumb sucking, digit sucking, tongue thrust, results anterior open bite, V-shaped palate, protrusive teeth. These are permanent skeletal damage that may need ortho intervention later on in a child's life. So it's important to eliminate those habits early on. Now, the magic timeline perhaps is that if a child can quit any oral habit before the age of 3, there's a good chance that self-correction would take place, meaning the pressure, the lips would push back the teeth. Whereas if the poor oral habit, okay, such as thumb sucking, digit sucking, continue to persist or even pacifier past the age of 3 and a half, then there's a great chance they're gonna have permanent damage to the skeletal, okay? So it's a good information to advise the parents to stop early, okay? And absolutely do not let the baby sleep with the bottle or walk with it, okay? Okay. Now, let's talk about oral health assessment and care risk assessment for young baby and children. Before we conduct care risk assessment, this is important that we establish our equipment onto a tray. It would comprise of 2x2 rods, okay? Direct light source, right? Toothbrush, fluoride varnish, latex gloves, plastic mirror, a tongue plate, and floss. The 2x2 rods, okay, why? The reason, because when you brush teeth, you're going to generate a lot of saliva, a lot of fluid, so 2x2 rods would be readily available for use. So you use like a towel, you wipe off the excess fluid. The direct light source for better examination inside the oral cavity. Toothbrush, I usually introduce the toothbrush first because that is a very familiar object for the child and the child tend to tolerate it quite well versus any strange instrument like Explorer or mirror, right? Once a child gain trust, then you can do more, okay? Fluoride varnish should be readily available. If you have a dental mirror, a plastic mirror is great. If not, just use tongue plates and floss. I really like to use floss also because not only after I brush, I show parents how to floss. I mean, the idea is that food bacteria tend to get stuck between the interproximal of the teeth, and floss is the way to get in there and clean the surface. The bristle toothbrush may not be able to go in there, nor the water pick, doing a very effective job of cleaning. I mean, the concept is quite simple. When we brush teeth, we brush hard and smooth surfaces, right? And we can't get into the interproximal area. If you don't floss, those interproximal surfaces are basically untouched, okay? It's dirty with all the food and bacteria persisting there and carries this thing to happen. Okay, there's 6 steps for care risk assessment. Let's talk about step 1. So begin assess the risk factors, okay, and the protective factors. So what are risk factors and what are protective factors? For example, okay, we will ask questions about family history of caries. If the mom, dad, or primary caretaker have history of active dental caries, high bacterial counts, those are risk factors. However, with the parents who do not have a history of dental diseases or caries, that's a good thing, okay? How about sibling in the family? Okay, family have more sibling, tend to have more dental caries also. Socioeconomic, okay, is also associated with caries experience, right? Whether the child use the bottle, okay? Prolonged bottle use or other dietary habits, okay? The frequency, durations of sugary drinks, okay, juices, snacks, etc. Developmental disability or special needs. If a child has special needs, is it difficult for the child to clean the teeth, okay? So, assess water, whether water is fluoridated or not. Fluoridated water would be a protective factor, okay? Home care and the use of fluoridated toothpaste. A child use fluoridated toothpaste, again, is a protective factor. And the concept of dental home, meaning that if the parents recognize a child has some sort of dental diseases, or maybe you see one ask a question and show a certain thing, they can call up a dental office and bring the child there. The concept of dental home means that when they need help, they know where to go. Okay. When the child come in, initially try to establish a rapport, okay? Talk to the child, I mean, play with them, talk to the child. You can use the puppet, toothbrush. Show the child how teeth can be brushed. I mean, the concept again is behavior management. Tell show do. You're gonna tell the child what you're gonna do, then you show it, and eventually go in the mouth and do it, okay? You can use toys, a baby toothbrush for the extraction. You can use staff to occupy the child while doing the interview with the parents. I mean, children learn much better by visual, and less with verbal communication. Even before you go into a child's mouth, right? Even to explore it, you ought to pretend like, use a finger and ask them, imagine this is your teeth. You can run the little explorer onto the tip of the finger and count them slowly. And event slowly, gradually go into the teeth, okay? Child learned with a mirror. It's good to have a child hold a mirror and look at the procedure and you explain to them. It's good to introduce a little song. Nursery rhyme like A, B, C, D, E, F, G, is helpful. Or twinkle, twinkle, little star while you do it. Make it fun, okay? Make it enjoyable and less threatening scenario, situation. Next, before you want you to conduct an exam, it's important to do a knee-to-knee position. Let me describe it to you. You open up the child legs, like straddle against the mom or the dead waist, and knees of the parent will touch the knees of the dentist or the provider. When you're ready, the child will be laid down in a supine position. Then you would ask the parent to secure the wrist, both wrists of the child. The provider, the dentist, will take care of the head. And that way you have rate control. I mean, you can start out with an exam of the child's mouth to see the amount of plaque. I mean, healthy plaque, that would be a disease factor, right? So we can record that in your caries risk assessment form. You do exam. And then before you do anything else, you should introduce a toothbrush, okay? Introduce a toothbrush is a very familiar object, so it's less threatening for the child. Once the child realizes it, it's not so bad, they let you do more, okay? Yeah. Okay. And then after that, I would introduce flossing, okay? Not only you clean the teeth, but also you try to show the parents how mom and dad can actually help the child at night. A lot of time, mom and dad tend to brush teeth when the child stand up. In that position, it's really easy. It's effective to brush the lower posterior teeth, but for the upper posterior, particularly on the buccal surface, the buccal cheek gonna be in the way, it's very hard. I find it a lot more effective, a lot easier to lay the child supine. It could be on the sofa, could be in bed, etc. You brush teeth that way. A lot of time, parents would say, well, my kid with an open mouth. Well, you can use two toothbrushes then. One of which you can use the handle position on one side and the other one you just kind of circle a motion, okay, on the other side and switch. That way the child can maintain opening. Okay, and expect a child to cry. Why? I mean, any kids under 3 years old, they do not have the cognition or the ability to follow instruction too well, okay? In the pre-cognitive stage of development, not yet able to cooperate, okay? So they're gonna cry. Cry because they have separation anxiety, cry because the dentist, the provider, is a stranger, okay? So you have to communicate this point with the parents, assuring them that crying is normal, crying is healthy, and we're expecting that. And when the child cries, they open mouth, why for you to examine? Isn't that great? Okay, you can see the teeth very clearly, okay, when a child cries. Now, tip for behavior management. A lot of time a child cry because they just don't want to be there, okay? You have to focus on the nature of the crown, the intensity of the sound, okay? A sharp pain that induces a cry would be screaming, okay? It's totally different, the cry that they're whining, okay? So, your distraction techniques. Again, I mentioned earlier, I like to sing. I like to sing nursery rhyme while I do an exam. It's really soothing and relax a child when you sing, okay? Tell show do. I almost every time I have to do this technique before I enter into a child's mouth. I usually start out with my explorer. Okay, I use a name just like tooth counter. Okay, and I run it on the finger. Then I get the child hold a mirror. Then I run the tip explorer onto the incisor edges of the anterior teeth because this is easy to reach. And a child see that, they go, huh, it's not so bad. And I gradually move back, okay? And then do the exam, okay? Before I do a prophy, I usually let the child hold the tip of my toothbrush. I call them toothbrush. You can personicate Mr. This, Mr. That, if you want to. The suction would be Mr. Straw, or the straw. Mr. Bumby, that's another name for the prophy. Ask a child to squeeze a tip of the rubber cup first. It's soft and it's gentle. And then you instruct the child, you can press on the paddle, and the tip of the profi cup will rotate. And you ask them to imagine these are your teeth. And let's see Mr. Bumby gonna ride along on the tooth surface, okay, and clean this way. And so you can massage the fingernail, okay, of a child, one by one, and you count it. And then gradually you go in the mouth, and you would do profi on the two upper incisors first. And just tell them, I say, you see, Mr. Bumby gonna move along. And you see, Mr. Bumby on the bus go round and round. I mean, anything you want, right? Keep gonna like it. And then eventually you say, huh, we done the front. Now let's move in the back. They open wide for you, okay? Just have to be really, really patient for this child. And once they like you, they become assets. I mean, they're gonna stay with you for your practice for the rest of, well, maybe 18, 19 until you graduate them. Okay, child will cry, but make sure, above all, you have to stay calm. Keep your heart rate low. Recognize that is a normal response. Explain that to the parents so nobody have heart attack and high blood pressure here. Unnecessary, okay? It's very normal. Okay, step three. After you examine the teeth for evidence of plaque, evidence of stain, you know, then you can hold a toothbrush, you just in flat position and gently massage the upper anterior, posterior, etc. Okay, to remove the plaque. And then while doing it, you also do the discussion of home care. You do the demonstrations of toothbrush and flosses. I mean, when you have space between teeth, you don't have to floss. But eventually when the posterior primary molar erupt, these teeth are gonna be in tight contact, and therefore you can go in there and flossing them, okay? Reinforce the use of small smear layer for a toothpaste, okay? Once in a while, you will see parents who would argue with you the use of fluoride, okay? Because they felt that it's not optimal, it can be potentially toxic. You can explain scientifically for them, but at the end of the day, they don't listen to you, just not try to fight them. Then encourage them to brush with water then, okay? The main idea is to mechanically remove the plaque, the biofilm that stick on teeth, okay? But having fluoride would be optimal. Okay, cleaning the teeth at home. Teeth cleaning should begin when the tooth erupted, okay? So just gentle massage, even just two O&P, two lower central primary incisor, and also massage the gum on the back, even the ridge, okay? Even though there's no teeth back there. Okay, and then you let the parents or older child practice, okay, and you watch, and then brace for the effort, and then you jump in, you say, let me see how can I improve it, okay, and you show them how to brush a little bit more effective. I mean, the idea is you try to capture their interest and you modify for greater success. Okay, the clinical aspect of care risk assessment. Making sure you look to make sure that there's a presence of thick plaque, because again, plaque could be a disease factor. I mean, having plaque more likely to contribute to caries formation, poor gingival health, gingivitis. In severe cases, is periodontitis, but in young children, you don't tend to see periodontitis. When you see a child with perio or root exposure, usually it's implied a child has some sort of childhood cancer or immunocompromised conditions or inherited connective tissue diseases, okay? Looking for jocular white spot, which is a CBNDK. This is, again, disease factor, okay? Any brown spot, any obvious dental caries, these are disease factors, okay? As soon as you recognize that white spot lesion, for example, I mean, the child basically automatically categorized as a high risk for caries, for caries development. Any evidence of tooth defects, meaning whether the child has systematic or inherited enamel defect or dentin defect. For example, if a child has molar incisor hypomelization, okay, or whether the child was born with inherited enamel defect or amelogenesis of a factor or dentinogenesis of a factor, okay, whether the child was born with a syphilis infection with a moon-shaped incisor, okay, upper incisor, and as well as mulberry molar, and any evidence of conjunctivitis, keratitis. Those are the triads for the syphilis infection. So So that's just an example of a tooth defect, okay? Because when you have a tooth defect, the tooth surface tend to be rough and is porous, and it tend to have bacteria readily to bind those surfaces when the enamel is not optimal with the hardness, so caries tend to develop pretty easily. And looking for inadequate salivary flow. When children undergo chemotherapy or X radiations, they may have obstruction of reduced salivary flow. The reason because the treatment would destroy salivary cell, okay? Hypertrophic. So reduce the salivary flow would reduce the buffering capacity. And therefore, the pH in the oral cavity tend to be lower, and plaque tend to develop. So caries is bound to develop also. I mean, the treatment is you try to stimulate saliva, perhaps use sodium bicarbonate rinse. That would be very helpful. We could prescribe Prevadent for children, perhaps 5 years or older, because they can brush and they spit it out, okay? And more frequencies of recall and Flyvanus applications, okay? So there's a number of treatment to provide. But at this point, what you do, caries assessment, you just try to collect all this disease factor. So we collect the risk factor and disease factor, okay? And also protective factor, and you put them on a balance to see where the child stands. The white spot or gingival inflammation. Okay. This example of a cerebral cavity, white spot lesion on the left, and gingival inflammation, meaning that the gum tend to be inflamed, is bulbous, is red, and when you brush it, it's going to bleed. Okay, bleeding doesn't mean it hurt the child. Okay, it just means that the gum is being inflamed. So in gingivitis, or gingival inflammation, is a reversible process, meaning that if we continue to brush well for another 2 weeks or so with good plaque control, the gingiva will heal. And once it heals, it becomes firm and pink. And you brush, there's no bleeding. Okay, that's the goal that we try to establish. Okay, this example of early childhood caries, it can vary from mild, moderate to severe. Example of usually baby on bottle. Prolonged exposure to milk, and when it happened from all the teeth, okay, it's pretty severe. And, right, teach the parents how to do the exam. Use a finger, lift up the lips, show the caregiver, okay, any signs of tooth decay. Show them to recognize the pattern of discolorations by lifting up the lips and exam monthly. And check for any chalky, white spot, or brown spot location. And if so, detect any, perhaps they should bring the child to a dental home, dental office, and let the dentist look at it. Okay. So once we collect all those critical clinical components, and then we assess risk, whether the child's high risk, moderate risk, or low risk. For example, for high risk, the child had to have active disease or a recent disease activity, such as white spot lesion, even just one, okay? Whether the child have caries, lesion in the previous 12 months, this is the history of active disease here, or whether the active caries in the caregiver. The moderate risk presence of the risk indicator, but no active diseases, such as you can see visible plaque, okay? You can see frequent carbohydrate exposure. This is risk factor, but no carry lesion in the previous months. And low risk is when oral hygiene is healthy, no evidence of gingivitis, no plaque, absence all those factors, okay? Either risk factor category or disease factor category, and the child have protective factors such as fluoride, toothpaste, good dietary exercises, you know, with vegetable in diets, frequent brushing and flossing in the morning, at night, etc. Then, you know, teeth with open spaces, things like that. So low risk is right. That's what the goal we want to achieve. Okay. And step 5 is to apply fluoride. Okay. Dry the teeth and apply it when the contact saliva, they set and sustained release over time. Okay. Okay, this is how you do fly varnish procedure. Again, I mentioned that you try to keep the 2x2 laws. Okay, then you open the packet of varnish, use the tip of the brush and just mix it up. Stir up with an applicator, then paint the varnish on the child teeth. Use the term perhaps like, I want to put a vitamin on your teeth, okay? And the vitamin make your teeth stronger, okay? All right, you don't have to put a lot as long as contact on teeth, that's all you need. And have the child spit out of the cup. If you want to do suction, that's okay, but making sure that some of the resin may clog up your suction tube, and therefore you may have to replace the filter by the end of the day. So be careful, okay? Pretty easy application to do. All right, this is fly varnish procedure, okay? And some people say that they rather apply the front, the upper teeth first because the tongue would not taste the bad taste of fly varnish and the kid can freak out and cry. I don't care either way. You can apply the front, the upper teeth first, and rather you move down to the lower or the lower and then move up to the front, the back, no problem. The upper, front, and upper back. Just develop the pattern, whatever that work for you, okay? Okay? Whenever you're in doubt, make sure you follow the manufacturer instruction, and these are the package. Now, parent instruction. If you discover any mild yellow or brownish color that may disappear when the teeth are brushed, this is extreme staining. I mean, may not, if brushing will not remove it, prophy cup will. Extrinsic staining, such as the extrinsic stain used to fly iron supplement, can be removed by prophy cup. Once in a while, you will see intrinsic staining, localized intrinsic staining. That's perhaps due to a child that begin to learn how to walk, and when they walk, they may fall, they bump here and there, and then they cause internal bleeding. The pigmentation, the pigments, the blood pigmentation will incorporate into the dentinal tubules, and therefore it's caused discoloration. At that stage, I wouldn't conclude that the tooth is dead yet, because it's going to revitalize and then it lined in the tooth and then no problem. But if it turned the trauma, turn out to be, to cause a deep dark gray onto the teeth, and you take a PA, periapical film, and show radiolucency, infections, abscess may develop, then you can definitely conclude that it's dead tooth and extraction is indicated, okay? After apply fluoride varnish, right, you don't have to brush that night, okay? Just let the benefit of fly varnish stick to teeth last until the day after. And actually, they sustainly release at a lower and lower concentration for the next week after you apply fly varnish. The highest concentration release come out immediately the day after you apply, but there's still some amount release over time, okay? At the much less concentration, the gradual reduce, okay? When it's all done, then you raise the child back into the caregiver arms for comforting. I mean, they cry, and by the time you sit them up into the mom lap or that, then the child may stop crying. Give them the toothbrush, use the toothbrush you use, okay? Wash it, put it into the packet and hand it to them so they can use it at home. Praise the child for good effort and give them stickers, some toys for them to play with, etc. while you talk to the parents. Okay, motivational interview. This is an important concept also because you learn how to ask questions, and then the most important thing is listen to respond to the parents, see what captured them, what motivated them, and you build from there, okay, by establishing one or two small goals so that they can go home and start helping, okay? They can say, yeah, I tried to brush my child's teeth, but he wouldn't open the mouth. I thought that brushing teeth caused bleeding. It's hurt my child, but you know, but at least you know that the parents are motivated to help with toothbrushing, okay? So then you say, sure, let me help you, okay? And you explain the concept of why the gingival bleedings take place, and you assure them it doesn't cause any pain. That's because of bacteria called inflammation. Encourage them to let the child brush teeth first in the morning and at night, okay? And then the adult have to come in and say, hey, let mom and daddy check to see any sugar bugs remain or stay in your teeth, and use simple language. Then the adult have to use a toothbrush and brush. because the young child will not develop mental dexterity until they're 6 years old, okay? Two or three, they just can't brush too well, okay? So they need some help from the parents. Once you establish that, you can motivate the parents engage in the routine oral hygiene for a young child, okay? And say that we will check on the status of gingival bleeding next time you come back for the visit, okay? Set them up for a simple goal so they can go home and help the child together they can achieve that goal, okay? Step number six, okay, is a summary and goal setting. And then here you have to summarize the findings, okay, follow up and home care, okay? So once you summarize the finding, you would establish whether the child is high, moderate, or low risk for disease or caries development. Then we establish a follow-up schedule. Would it be they come back at 3 to 4 months for another caries risk assessment if they belong to extreme high risk category, okay? Or they should come back once every 6 months, okay, for the moderate kind. If they are low risk, you may bring them come back 12 to 18 months perhaps, okay? And emphasize the important oral hygiene at home, okay? And dietary recommendations also. Again, I'll talk about that a while ago with regard to toothbrush and floss, okay? And also reduce the frequency and duration of fermentable carbohydrate challenging, okay? That would summarize everything I said earlier without going into another example, okay? Discuss the risks that we found, if any, okay? If you identify the risk factor or the disease factor, we have to discuss about it is and help the parents how to reduce these risk factors, okay? Set up small goals, not too much. So choose 1 to 2 key concepts or messages, okay? Non-judgmental and be friendly, okay? No blaming, because some parents will be very sensitive, I mean culturally sensitive. No blaming, meaning that don't say that, oh, caries happen because you don't brush your child's teeth, okay? They would immediately say, what are you talking about? You suggest that I'm a bad parent, I don't care for my kid's teeth. You never know, right? So always put the child in the center. Whatever you do or say, the child is the most important thing, okay? Your message have to be tailored toward the oral hygiene improvement of the child, okay? And the parent accept those kind of messages really well. No blaming. Be surprised, okay? always remain positive, okay? Okay. So in order to change a health behavior, whether this is oral health behavior, it doesn't take overnight, okay? It takes a slow process, okay? And it's going to be persistent. We just improve one step at a time and often take many triggers, and one has to be persistent and deliver over a long period of time. Okay, you try to incorporate with personal own experience and the value in order to change it. Okay. So when I show the child how to brush and floss and try to educate the oral hygiene, it doesn't happen just after one visit. It happened after multiple visits, and the message has to be repeated. The demonstration must be repeated. And once a child get it, you're going to instill into the child for the rest of his or her life. That's what we want to achieve, okay? Documentation. Write down what you find, okay? If you identify certain complex dental conditions that beyond the help of non-dental provider, then perhaps it's a good time to refer to a general dentist who will see children or to a pediatric dentist, okay? So that the child can receive appropriate dental care. Okay, disease management. Once in a while, you will see occlusal caries, okay, on a child, a very young child where behavior can be difficult. There's no equipment, there's no hand pieces, but if you invest into silver diamine fluoride or SDF, you can apply SDF, and on top of that, you apply glass ionomer. And this material can self-cure. No need to light cure if it's pure glass ionomer. So silver diamine fluoride is a new FDA-approved device that known as, it was approved because of Denton sensitivity prevention, not so much of caries treatment. It was approved as a device, because if it were approved as a drug, it have to go through multiple clinical trial, perhaps three of them, two of which can be the US one, could be abroad, could be very costly. So, but regardless, it's safe, right? You can dry the teeth, apply silver-diamine fluoride. It will stain the teeth after the application. The way it works is silver is known to kill bacteria by preventing DNA replication. It's also from a very hard layer, the barrier, known to be silver phosphate. And it contains high concentration of fluoride ions, which is about 44,800 or so ppm of fluoride, okay? This is the highest concentration, even more than Prevagen, which is a prescription toothpaste, okay, that we prescribe to high-risk caries patients that are 5 or 6 years or older. That toothpaste contains about 22,000 parts per million. So with high concentrated fluoride, it's helped to also kill bacteria, and at the same time, it's promote remineralization, okay, reduce demineralization. They also have another byproduct, which is ammonia, okay? So that's how silver-diamine fluoride works. And once you apply that, dry it to the surface, if it's possible, you apply another layer of glass enema on top, and it's set. That's called smart technique, okay? And it works quite well for a young child. This can potentially completely avoid GA visit or oral constant sedation, which could be dangerous and life-threatening. I do quite a bit of practice nowadays. Even my faculty practice uses silver-diamine fluoride and glass enema application on top. It's a smart technique, okay? And I can control quite a bit of dental diseases. A lot of times, they ride for many years even. And if it need to reapply, we do that, okay? Sometimes a child just need to hold it in place for a year or two, and the cognition begin to develop, and they become a helper with Ray Corporation and dental chair, so that the dentist can do more definitive restorations, such as a stainless steel crown, perhaps, on that tooth. But it's quite effective. Now, how do we do interim therapeutic restoration? The ITR, if you just want to apply glass enema only without SDF, this is it. Minimal cavity preparation, no injection, no drilling, none of that, okay? You can scoop out the decay if the child allow you. You can do the slow ground burn if the child allow you. If not, you don't really have to. You can squirt or apply fluoride release glass enema. I mean, glass enema have this is aluminum fluorosilicate, and they also have carboxylic acid, and they go to acid-base reaction when it's set. It release fluoride, and you know what fluoride does, promote remin and prevent demin, bactericidal. And this material can recharge too, because it can take up the fluoride. When the child drink water and brush with fluoride toothpaste, etc., and they continue to provide benefit for fluoride release. It's interesting though. There's no a clear direct clinical trial, okay, showing the direct beneficial effect of fluoride and tertiary care prevention from glass enema, but this material releases quite a bit of fluoride, so we do deductive reasoning. I continue to check up. I important. After you apply ITR, the reason because these restorations can come off and we may have to reapply. We already talked about silver-diamine fluoride. Again, they have the antibacterial properties. Fluoride promote remin, okay? And inhibit demineralization. You could combine both, okay? Silver-diamine application, SDF application, and glass enema, okay? That's why they call smart technique. So they have FDA approved for tooth sensitivity, but we use it off-label for carrier rest. That's fine. I consider if high risk, you see the child perhaps once every 3 to 4 months. If moderate risk, you can treat perhaps 1 or 2 times a year, and low risk, you know, maybe just 1 time a year instead, okay? Reinforce home care, right? it is what the family do at home that really counts. Again, this message I have already talked early on when I start out a lecture, meaning that doesn't matter. It really doesn't matter what the dentist do, all the restoration, do all the prophy in the dental office, but the oral hygiene habit at home has not changed. All the bacteria will come back, all the decay experience, the prevalent will come back, okay? So what take place at home, really important, meaning the child have to start and brush in the morning and at night and floss, as well as all the good dietary counseling, reducing frequency and durations of sugar, acidic drinks, and fermentable carbohydrate challenging, okay? Follow-up visit. Children who have received infant caries risk assessment early on in life often make excellent future dental patients. This is so true. If a child comes to see a dentist early on, even though the first two visits are sort of cry bloody murder, okay? That's all right. But as a child grow, they get used to the environment. I mean, they learn. Children learn so much. They're like a blank sheet of paper. You can mold them, you can shape them the way you want it. Okay, just be patient with them, and soon they become the great helper for your practice. Okay, they get fair comfortable with you very soon. Okay, that's the joys out of practicing with children right there. Even if they cry, they don't take it personal. They will hug you afterward. Okay, they give you a high five. Okay, so it's very fun and enjoyable working with children. Okay, sixth step. Here it is. Interview, position the child lap to lap, toothbrush prophy, floss, demonstration, do the clinical CRA caries assessment, okay, to collect all the evidence of risk factor and disease factors, okay, apply fluoride varnish, and then summarize, establish a small baby goal so that the parents and the child can accomplish at home, and then we're going to check it later at the recall for the improvement. Okay, healthy smile, California children. Again, practicing with children is the joys of my life, and I hope for yours as well. I mean, together, professional or non-professional or healthcare provider, we can work together. We're gonna provide excellent oral health for our children and try to put them onto the early path of excellent oral health for the rest of his or her life. That's the goal, okay? Thank you very much. Listening. All right. See you next time. Bye.